Cui folosește o Europa centrală și de est dezvoltată economic? În primul rând, cetățenilor care trăiesc aici pentru că pot avea un nivel de trai ridicat. În al doilea rând, întregului continent pentru că se reduc decalajele care există deja pe diferite paliere între vest și est. Iar în al treilea rând, securității comune. Am fost în Polonia, țara unde s-a lansat inițiativa celor trei mări, să aflăm care sunt stadiile proiectelor la care lucrează 12 state, printre care și România. Sunt Cristina Cileacu, începe Pașaport Diplomatic.
Douăsprezece țări din zona Mărilor Baltic, Adriatică și a Mării Negre au un proiect comun de creștere economică numit Inițiativa celor trei mări. Statele din estul Uniunii Europene își doresc să reducă decalajul de dezvoltare pe care îl au față de țările din vest. Așa a apărut ideea de a conecta regiunea pe trei paliere: energetic, infrastructură și digitale. Reușita inițiativei celor trei mări înseamnă de fapt prosperitate pentru întreaga Uniune Europeană, dar și cooperare economică mai aplicată cu Statele Unite. Dacă statele vestice sunt conectate între ele de infrastructură pe diferite paliere, țările din Europa Centrală și de Est sunt în continuare fără prea multe legături între ele din punctul de vedere al infrastructurii moderne, iar axa care contează cel mai mult este cea care se întinde de la nord la sudul regiunii celor trei mări.
All the 12 countries of the three seas are eager to work with each other, but who is basically coordinating this work?
I think that as we develop the initiative every year, we get more and more countries that actually are feeling more of an ownership in the initiative. They are more engaged, and I think it's a perfect example of all the countries that have organized the three seas summits. In fact, the crucial moment, I believe, that when we started to actually implement practical projects in life was the summit in Bucharest, when all the countries presented their priority projects, and then we started to both public investment, also looking for private investors, establishing Three Seas Initiative Investment Fund. And as we speak, right now it was Bulgaria this year, it will be Latvia next year with the presidency. So it is not about the leadership of one country that is being followed by the others, but rather of competing with each other who is more engaged. And so far, I believe, especially if we compare it to the initial situation when this was an initiative of the presidents of Croatia and Poland, later on joined by other leaders, and we have been asked numerous questions. What is it for? Is it something against the EU? Is it something alternative to the EU? Obviously, it's not. It is essentially going in the direction, hand in hand with the European integration, actually enforcing it, strengthening it. So now, as we are cooperating between all the 12 countries, we are glad to see that this joint leadership, this mutual understanding of common interest of all of our countries as the whole Central Eastern Europe is of essential importance to all the governments, and we are developing very dynamically.
Potențialul regiunii celor trei mări este deja conștientizat de fiecare dintre cele 12 state care fac parte din această inițiativă. Însă, dincolo de discuții, este nevoie de proiecte concrete care să fie puse în practică în prezent. Un astfel de exemplu este Via Carpatica, un coridor de transport care să traverseze Europa din nord spre sud prin Lituania, Polonia, Slovacia, Ungaria, România, Bulgaria și Grecia. Partea din acorduri politice și diplomatice este rezolvată deja. Banii se găsesc, mai rămâne realizarea efectivă a acestei autostrăzi europene.
The bottom line key of this initiative is potential of our countries. Definitely it's a good word, but of course people need to see projects.
So I think if there's something that makes Three Seas Initiative different from many other political formats is the fact that it has so much practical implication on projects, on infrastructure projects, in transport, energy and digital. And as we look at how quickly our countries are developing, are building connections, especially on the north-south axis, projects such as Via Carpathia, such as the connection of our gas terminals to interconnectors, enhancing our energy independence, being more resilient as Central Europe, and also very hugely investing in digital cooperation, I believe this is the essence. Not that politicians make diplomats travel here and there. This is obviously important, it helps to bring awareness, but in fact these practical implications actually matter. And today we are actually meeting in a different format. We are more often, very often we are speaking about this hard, tangible projects in infrastructure. But today we meet with young leaders from all across Central Europe to discuss what is the future, what are the needs for the future generations, because these infrastructure projects are going to be built for decades, are going to serve for ourselves, but also our children for the decades to come. In order to shape it in an appropriate way, we need to listen, we need to hear what people have to say, because these people will be shaping the future of Europe.
And what does the new generation of Europe says about its needs?
Most of all, I believe we recognize that there is a huge still, huge need, huge unexplored potential for stronger cooperation, stronger, more intense exchange between ourselves. Very often, us Poles, we do not know what's happening in Czechia, in Hungary, in Romania, in Bulgaria, or we are getting to know what's happening there reading international press, for example, French, German, or British press. It is not the way it should be. We should be getting in touch directly with ourselves, getting to know each other, establish channels of communication, media, cooperation between our young leaders, groups of activists, of NGOs, of political, of journalist leaders, that will be actually delivering this information, encouraging people to get closer to each other, to exchange, and thus creating this mutual understanding, because more than anything else, above all else, we are connected by common history, common culture, common traditions, and also common ambitions. I think that's the most important thing.
Cetățenii celor 12 state ale inițiativei celor trei mări se cunosc destul de puțin între ei. Unul dintre motive poate fi și faptul că suntem mai degrabă atrași de națiunile la care am visat cât timp Europa de Est era sub comunism. Mi se pare că nu prea avem ce învăța de la cineva care a trecut printr-o istorie asemănătoare nouă, dar această atitudine este greșită. În cele trei decenii care au trecut de la căderea regimurilor dictatoriale din estul continentului nostru, fiecare dintre țările noastre s-a schimbat mai mult decât ne place să credem. Iar aceste evoluții sunt bune.
When we transitioned from communism to a free market economy, then we obviously had one big ambition, and all the countries shared it, to integrate with the West, to reintegrate the whole continent, join the EU, join NATO, cooperate and be on the same level as the Western countries such as Germany or France or Italy. And this was obviously very important. And we managed to do that. We joined the EU in 2004, 2007, later than that. And we were actually doing something which many believed it wouldn't succeed, that we wouldn't be able to do it. We managed to do that. We actually even, I think, outpaced the expectations. And this was very important. But at the same time, we somehow neglected the need to get closer connected to each other within our region. Because we're so focused on integration with the West, it was hugely important, but we should never forget who we are, never forget where we come from, and never forget that we have friends close to home. So I believe now is the time, in this decade, to integrate better, especially in the Central Europe, because we have a lot of potential. If we will be able to explore it and use it for the common good, we will be actually the strongest part of Europe.
Uniunea Europeană are bani și folosirea lor a ridicat nivelul de trai al cetățenilor din blocul comunitar, ce-i drept diferit de la un stat la altul, în funcție de cât de implicate au fost guvernările în accesarea banilor de la Bruxelles. Inițiativa celor trei mări are, pe lângă finanțările din bugetele locale și din cele europene, și un fond de investiții comun, la care sunt contribuții ale țărilor partenere, dar se așteaptă și investiții private.
Oh, I think we use these money very smart, but we can always do better. Because when we would only focus on integration with West and build connections from West to East, these connections were very important, and through doing this we were actually able to reintegrate our part of the continent to the rest of the European Union. This helped us a great deal. But the trick here is to combine this vector of development with the one that is also very important, connecting on the north-south axis, the countries of our region, connecting also with our neighbors, also with the countries that are not members of the EU, with the Western Balkans, with the Eastern Partnership countries, because they are also looking to us, they also want to be connected, to cooperate, to do joint projects with us. And when we speak about the money, obviously one could say that there is an abundance of it, but in fact the needs are even bigger. IMF estimates that we will need in Central Europe to spend at least 600 billion euros just this decade, just the next 10 years, to simply catch up with the level of development of our infrastructure. So it's a lot. In order to do that, we need to combine, I think, three main sources. One is the Three Seas Fund, is obviously important, but this is funding this on more private, on more commercial driven basis. What really matters is the public spending, both from national budgets, also from EU budgets, because if we will be able to create a plan for development in Central Europe to connect us better using smart these money, we will actually be able to take full advantage of what the chances that lie ahead of us.
Pe lângă Via Carpatica, un alt proiect grandios pe care și-l propune inițiativa celor trei mări este conectarea porturilor Gdansk și Constanța. Din perspectiva românilor care trăiesc în țara care are autostrăzi mai mult pe hârtie, ideea pare ireală. Din perspectiva polonezilor, proiectul este realizabil. Timpul va demonstra cine a avut dreptate, dar recunoaștem, de data aceasta, ne-ar plăcea să aibă dreptate Polonia.
We are constructing very intensively the Via Carpatia connection between the Baltic countries to Poland, Slovakia, Hungary, down to Romania, Bulgaria. We want to go to Greece and then also Turkey. We are also.
And the deadline for that?
Oh, it depends on various countries, obviously. Hungarians are almost done. Poland will be done within 2-3 years. Slovakia, perhaps a year later. So Romania is also doing quite good on that. We are cooperating with another project. There is this very ambitious project of joining the Poles in Constanza and Gdańsk, especially in terms of energy supplies, gas supplies. This is what we are going to need in the coming years as we want to transform to a greener economy. Gas as being this fuel for transformation will be essential, or energy security depends on that. Digitalization. We can follow examples of the leaders. Estonia is definitely one of them. But other countries are catching up. Poland is also catching up very strong. We have invested a lot in digitalization in the recent years. And this can actually be done. What we want to do is actually promote this idea of smart connectivity that embodies digital element in all branches of the economy, because in fact this is how it's going to look. And also we need to be resilient to cyber threats, so invest very strongly in cyber security. I'm absolutely sure that together Romania is one of the leaders of the initiative, one of the most ambitious countries that wants to drive these joint projects, and I'm absolutely certain that we will be able to, in the coming years, to implement many of them and to further develop Romania, Poland and other countries. When we look at our recent history, as we joined the EU 17 years ago, we joined Poland, Romania 14 years ago, we were really at that time very much underdeveloped compared to our neighbors. But after this decade and a half, we managed to do a lot. And everybody that comes from other countries to visit Warsaw, to visit Bucharest, to visit other capitals of Central Europe, agrees that this is actually a level of development that they didn't expect. So now we are at the moment of, I think, in really similar historical significance, because we can use this huge, as you said, lots of money are on the table. We should use them, we should be able to use them smart, and we will be able to do even more together.
Demografia este o problemă europeană pentru că populația de pe continent îmbătrânește și natalitatea este scăzută. Polonia are o strategie prin care să contracareze efectele acestui fenomen și se uită cu atenție spre România, care, în mod surprinzător, are a doua cea mai mare rată a fertilității la nivelul Uniunii Europene.
Minister, you are in charge of a strategy regarding the demographics, so in order to have the project of Three Seas Initiative done, we need a lot of people. How is Poland staying?
Yes, we have a big challenge with demography, like in almost all the European countries and also all the 12 countries in Three Seas Initiative. We see that our region, Three Seas region, is a region that is quite successful in coping with these challenges. I mean that the fertility rates in our countries are rather growing than falling, which is not the case in other countries. In Poland, we have this year announced the demographic strategy, which is the next step after bringing solutions to our families, to families in Poland. 5 years ago, with the change of the government, we introduced a huge program of direct transfers to families, which is very successful. Now it's time for us to also introduce some new instruments, some new measures in other areas, like in housing policy, in the labor market conditions, for especially for young women, and also with new measures for better work-life balance and introducing more possibilities of childcare systems. So we have a complex strategy which is now being under consultations in different institutions, stakeholders, and hopefully in September or October our government will accept it, and then we start implementing some projects. Some of them have already been done within the Polish deal. Polish deal is a new reform, new plan to boost the economic growth after the pandemic of COVID-19, and I am very satisfied that some of the projects that are very needed from the demographic perspective are already included in the Polish deal. So we are working very intensively, and we also try to see the good examples, good practices from other countries. Romania is one of them. We have in Romania the second highest fertility rate in Europe, which is very, very interesting for us how we do this. And we also watch very closely how other countries in our region are doing, because in Czech Republic, in Slovakia, in Hungary, in all those countries, we have growing fertility rates. And this is very optimistic, and it also gives us hope that we can also do better in this area, because it's possible.
Legile poloneze privind avortul au fost mereu printre cele mai stricte din Europa. Legislația care a intrat în vigoare la începutul acestui an le interzice femeilor să folosească această procedură cu foarte puține excepții.
How is the new law with abortion in Poland standing with this strategy?
Well, when we have done some research, some special research dedicated to the problems of family, of demography, of having kids, or all those perspectives and all those obstacles that Polish women and men, young and older, see in fulfilling their dreams about a family. We have found many different problems to which we try to find answers. And, for these reasons, we have those housing programs, we have those proposals of changing the labor code. Well, in Poland, the abortion was always a problem that have a strong pro-life society. And we see also those kinds of changes in other countries. I just mentioned United States and the recent new law in Texas that is more strict than our Polish. So I think that this is a kind of change that will happen also in other countries.
Menționam mai devreme că noi, est-europenii, știm destul de puține unii despre alții. România are deja câteva hub-uri IT recunoscute și inovațiile pe care le fac românii care lucrează în acest domeniu sunt folosite de cei din alte țări. Lipsa digitalizării este o problemă comună pentru multe state europene. Și aici, investițiile se fac mai mult sau mai puțin în funcție de cât de interesate sunt autoritățile naționale să elimine din decalajul pe care estul îl are comparativ cu vestul și în această privință.
We still have much to do in terms of reducing the technological gap between our countries and Western countries. And the EU average spending on research and development is on the level of some 2.2% of GDP. In Poland, for example, is 1.52% of Polish GDP. And we still have much to do in terms of investing in research and development. Digitalization is not only about social media and sending emails. Digitalization is all about making our government work more smoothly, our authorities work more smoothly. Digitalization means that we are able to communicate with local authorities in the new ways, via internet, via special platforms of communication. All of these can greatly be great help in starting new businesses, great help in doing everyday life decisions and so on. The pandemic year changed a lot because we've learned to do many things actually by using internet, and we now we can do a lot by, from, I don't know, paying taxes to register new cars and so on. It is a first very important step for our country, and we did it quite well. We have government-connected agencies which are doing those things very well. Right now we are spending a lot of money on digitalizations in primary schools, which is a very good program because it enables young people to have contact with high techs from the very first year of their learning in primary school. From our experience, we have partners in Romania. Romania is a very important market for us. What can be interesting, we sell more 3D printers in Romania than we sell, for example, in Russia. Mm-hmm. So yes, Romania is a fast-growing country, very open to new technologies, and I think we can learn a lot from Romania.
Atât pentru astăzi, dar rămânem în continuare online pe pagina de Facebook a emisiunii și pe contul nostru de Twitter. Revenim cu subiecte noi din lumea diplomației și a politicii externe, vinerea viitoare de la 11:30 și reluare sâmbătă de la 22:30. La revedere!